Act 9, Sharnoth of the Deepest Black. That's the first act that is not divided into parts. That's interesting. Mary entered a room with no one in it and exhaled while feeling the cold air. She saw her breath turn white and realized how cold it was. As she thought about that, she groped along the walls of the dark room, found the light switch, turned on the engine light, and turned the key in the heating engine. Then she finally noticed two envelopes on the floor next to the door. They had probably been slipped through the side of the door. Mary thought Mrs. Hudson did that. Lately she'd been waking up late because she kept coming home late at night. It wasn't that she had to stay late at the Royal College. Her lecturers weren't running long. She wasn't in any research group. Even though no one would answer her if she asked why, even though no one was there. As she stood there, time passed. Before she realized it, it was past midnight. This has happened a few days in a row. Mrs. Hudson waited for her the first time. She asked Mary where she'd been, but Mary didn't know how to reply.
Jen.
She called a name, the name of a person who tried to tell her something. There was no response. She was the only one in the room now. She softly turned over the two envelopes in her hand. Two, the same as usual. She looked at the sender's names. One was from her uncle, the other. The other one was a telegram her mother had sent her from Kadath. She couldn't open it. She couldn't open her mother's words. She'd just taken the letter opener out of a desk drawer, but her hand was shaking. Her mother's face overlapped with Jane's. That was why she couldn't read it. Not yet. Her hand touched a notebook spread out on the desk. It hurt a little, but her mind wasn't directed towards it. The telegram. She opened the telegram from her uncle. She read it. The usual series of worried words, vague and aimless, but they conveyed his feelings. There has been more crime recently. Not a lot more, but make sure you never walk around outside at night. I want to see your face. I'm not that worried about you, and you are a woman now, but you're still in danger. She looked at the text, written far more hastily than usual. Was it just her imagination? She naturally thought of the meta-creatures, of the form of the monster Jane gave birth to, what seemed like a fantastic horse wrapped in muddy water. That might have attacked someone. A slight increase in crime. Those short words made Mary's chest hurt. She covered her mouth with her hands, keeping her quiet voice from leaking out. She couldn't put it into words. She couldn't. She couldn't think it. She mustn't speak of the monsters. A voice. She could hear a voice. It became sound and slid inside her. She covered her ears and shook her head. She couldn't hear it. She wasn't hearing anything like this. But she heard it anyway. She could tell someone was whispering inside her head.
Yeah.
A voice whispering that it was her fault, as if someone had appeared from behind to whisper in her ear. An illusion. And yet, she could hear it. A voice. A voice. A voice. A voice. Whose voice is that?
なぜ生きようとする私はサリをなぜ諦めないこの地上にただ一人生きるそんなものに意味など
やめて、やめてよ。私はただ、ただ。 私はその場にうずくまる。少しでも声から遠ざかりたくて。
Mary shook her head like a young child, throwing a tantrum, covering her ears, curling up on the floor. Drops fall from her eyes, many, many. They fall without end, forming a small stain on the wooden floor. Mary called Jane's name. There was no answer. There was no answer. She called Charlie's name, as if clinging to it. There was no answer. There was no answer.
お母さん.
She called for her mother, but there was no answer, there was no answer. There was only silence, the telegram envelope crumpled in her clenched hand. Then,
視界の端に一冊のノートがあった。私の絵本。シャーリーに続きを見せると約束した。あのお話が床にあった。机から落ちて、いびつに、歪んで。
Hot drops flowed. Heat slides down her skin. The water hurt a little since she'd set the shower temperature higher than usual, but it was fine. The heat wiped out the whispering voice, washing it down the drain at her feet. How long had she cried? She gazed at the room, her vision cloudy with tears. She noticed it, even though the whispering voice had lessened. She threw her clothes onto the bed and entered the bathroom. The shower that normally felt good hurt now. Of course it did. The temperature was too high. The voice disappeared from her mind. Countless hot drops produced several sounds. She put it into words, the same words which had echoed inside her head. Why? Why? Why?
タオルケットを一枚だけ羽織って部屋へ戻る。
Her lodging room, still a little dark even with the lights on. The air should have been warmer now, but it was cold. She could tell the heating engine wasn't running. She reached for the wall beside the door, but remember the activation key wasn't there. The key was in her bag. She thought that and looked towards her dresser.
衣装棚、その隣に誰かの姿があった。誰かを。
Someone was there. She couldn't have failed to recognize that person. It wasn't Jane Doe. It couldn't have been Ellie. It wasn't her mother. Yes, her mother couldn't have been there now. A tall silhouette. She didn't ask herself who it was. A black silhouette she'd never mistaken for anyone else. His right eye was hidden. His light blue left eye was looking at her, looking towards her from the darkness.
M. 見間違えたりしない。どんなに部屋が暗くて。彼が黒色でも。
四つのかがり火が揃った。
Four flames, what are you talking about? His words were brief. The light blue eye looked at Mary. He showed no surprise whatsoever at Mary's state of undress. Just the same cold eye as usual. Just the same cold voice as usual.
お前に。
His legs moved slightly, forwards, heading towards her. His voice came closer. The light blue eye floating in the darkness came closer. When had he? How had he? Mary wasn't thinking anything like that. M was in her room. She just accepted that definite truth.
これで残りは一回だ。故に、お前に確認することがある。
Only one more time? Could it be that this is the last act? She felt.
タオル一枚で彼の前にいること。その気恥ずかしさなんて何もない。裸を見られて、それが何だというの。そんなもの。そんなもの。
お前は。
The tall shadow approached her. Soon he was right in front of her, without any wavering, without any emotion.
言葉を続けようとする彼へ、私は。